Hello, my fellow DCS aviation enthusiast. I know there's been a lot of conversation about the SimPit Technologies system. The system I bought was the 202 field of view. At the end of the day, it does work. It looks really nice. But in preparation of getting there, it is a huge learning curve. Not from SimPit Technologies, but from the warp programs that are out there, Immersive Display Pro and Warpalyzer. None of them are going to be off the shelf perfect when you set it up, and the support that you get from these companies is, I don't want to say it's bad, but they get the idea that you know what you're doing. And I can tell you from experience, when I started, I had no clue what I was doing. So the answers that I received from them might as well have been in Braille. I have no idea what they were talking about. So I went through every video available that I could find on Vimeo or YouTube, and I still couldn't get the questions answered. So what I'm going to do for you, and by the way, I am no expert on warping programs. I am no expert on anything. I'm just telling you how I solve the problems, what worked for me, and what will resolve hundreds of hours of learning curves trying to get to this perfect non-ghosting picture. So if you have any comments, please throw them in the bottom and let me know your thoughts. But I'm just going to tell you what worked for me and what I did to overcome problems I found with the structure of the system, as well as the warping technologies and what I did to overcome them. First and foremost, if you're using a laser level to try and laser up all your lines and laser up all their squares, you are wasting your time. You will never, never get to this video presentation that you're looking at here. No matter how good your eyes are, you are not going to get those pixels aligned properly. The only way to do this, and the fastest way to do this, is using a camera, which I'll show you how to do. And it will align the pixels for you automatically and give you a perfect presentation every time. Now, if you're thinking that once you set this up, it's good for weeks, it's not. Your temperatures in your house, the humidity in your house, people walking across the floor, all kinds of things will affect these projectors. Even if you mount them in solid steel, if they move so much as 1 millimeter or the plastic expands or contracts, you're going to have ghosting in the picture. So if you played it 8 hours a day, every single day, I would say about every 3 days, you're going to wind up aligning the picture to get it right. But using the camera system, it's a 10-minute ordeal. It's not that big a deal. But if you're like me and you're very anal retentive on the presentation and the quality of it, I do it every time before I go into a play session. It doesn't matter because I'm going to be on it for quite some time and I want it perfect. So we played every game you could think of. This particular game, Red Dead Redemption, was the most incredible I had ever seen. Honestly, I bet I spent 20 minutes just sitting back having a drink looking at this picture, because I'm an idiot. I just thought it was really cool. Love playing Red Dead Redemption. It's like riding a real size horse. But anyway, why don't we just get to the guts of it, and I'm going to give you all the points that I know and that I fixed, so you can get that perfect presentation. All right, so we're just going to go through this step by step and piece by piece. So you might as well sit back and relax and get a drink. Speaking of drink, cheers. Nectar of the gods, I tell you. Okay. On the uprights, here's the first problem that you're going to run into that you won't figure out till later. This particular section here is made so that the entire screen, the upper and the lower supports, all move at the same rate if you need to raise it or lower it. So you need to figure out how high you want this to be. So for me, when I sit down, it's about waist level, between your waist and your belly button kind of thing. That's where I like the screen presentation to be for the desk that I'm sitting at or the desk you're going to put in here. The second thing is there is a screw that's in here. It's right here, or it's right on the outside, but it's right in that flat area there. What that screw is for is to stabilize the system so it doesn't move up and down. But it's not big enough and it won't do it. and you're going to be putting the weight of your projectors on there. And as you're monkeying around and playing and having a good time, you're going to notice up in the corner that your screen has a little loop in it because one of these things have fallen with all this weight on it. It's not big enough. So what I used was a self-tapping screw that was about an inch long, and I just ran it through there right into this aluminum bar. So I'm sorry, it's not here. It's up here. This is where it is, not on the bottom. This one slides through this device here. And they're supposed to slide and be perpendicular to each other. So this screw is what keeps them from sliding. But it's very small. And it's mounted in a piece of, I don't even know what this stuff is. It's not wood. It's some type of compressed material. It's not carbon fiber. But it's kind of soft. So as you try and tighten it to get it to stabilize the system, it will strip out and it won't hold it. So I just took it out. Went to the other side and put a screw through it. When I got to the position I want, I mean, how many times are you going to raise and lower your screen? I had my system for over a year and I never did. So do yourself a favor, put a screw in there and stabilize the system so it cannot move with all the weight of the projectors on. Okay, also, it's very important that you make sure before you mount the screen that this top system is exactly completely level. You got to check it from side to side and end to end. Make sure that it's level. And when the other portion that you finally get mounted, make your measurements and make sure they're exact all the way around. Because if they're not, when you go to mount your screen on there, it's going to get crooked on the ends and you're not going to be happy with the result. So those are the first things that need to be done. You need to get a screw in here, get it through this aluminum pipe so that this system cannot fall. You don't want the screw that's just pressurized against the aluminum pole. You want to go through the aluminum pole and cut into it with a self-tapping screw, and that way it'll be solid forever. Here's another trick that I learned that helped me out going in the future with this system, trying to get everything leveled up. Once you get those aligned and they're perfect and everything is stabilized where it cannot move with the weight of the projectors on top of the entire system, the next thing you're going to do is you're going to mount the screen. Now, a lot of guys, when they mount their screens, they don't think about what they're going to have to do later on to go out there and make sure everything is lined perfectly. So they just put the screws in there haphazardly around the screen. That is not the way to do it. You want to lay the screen on a carpeted surface with the presentation area down. On a 202 field of view screen, you want 21 screws on the top and 21 screws on the bottom. They have to be perfectly aligned with each other and they have to be equidistant all the way around the screen. The reason for this is with 21, you have a center mark and you have 10 marks on each side. So when you go out there to use your laser along with your camera system, that way when you line up the top screw with the bottom screw, they're exact. You don't have to mark your screen. You don't have to put tape on it. The screws are always going to be there. So you don't have to go and put marks on your screen or anything like that. Use the screws as your markers to line up your two projectors because they're always going to be the same. If you put marks on it or tape on your screen, it's never going to be the same. And they show in marks on your screen, no matter what they tell you, will show up in your video. It looks horrible. So what you're going to do is you're going to mark and drill holes in the screen equidistant for 21 screws. Now, if you're using a 270 Centurion, I would say the number would probably be 31. I haven't done the math on it, but if you send me a comment, I'll do the math, but I'm probably sure it'd be 31 screws, but 21 is the magic number. Get yourself a drywall square. They're $13. You can get them down at Lowe's or Home Depot. That's what they look like. They're about 4 feet long. And that way, when you make all of the holes in the top of the screen, you can turn this around, lay your square on there, and get the holes exactly perpendicular to the holes on the top all the way around. That way, it'll all match, and they'll laser up perfectly. It'll save you a lot of time, believe me. When it comes to mounting the projectors, there's a lot of flaws in the system, and which causes the picture quality to ghost a lot. If you live on a concrete slab, consider yourself lucky. But like me, I'm in North Carolina. I live in my house is on a crawl space. So every time somebody walks across the floor in my house, those vibrations are transferred through the floor, especially when they come into my office, my man cave, and stomp around. And the reason for that is, if you look up here, the way these are mounted, there's an aluminum pole that goes from this connector out to the projector, which I was talking about. There's a lot of weight hanging on these poles out here, along with my speakers that are up there. And these projectors are mounted on wooden bases, and they're made to be able to turn so that you can align them properly to get the overlap you need between the two projectors, which is all great and fun until somebody walks across the room and these things slide on this metal pole that's up here, and they will move. And if they move 1 millimeter, your picture is out. So if you're going to mount your projectors this way and not on the ceiling, which is what I did, by the way, if you're going to mount your projectors here for short throw projection, what you need to do is once you get to a picture that you think is going to be close enough that you can get it lined up, you need to put some angles up here and screw them into this aluminum so that these poles rest solidly against them where they cannot move. I put one on each side because once you find the place, the placement for the projectors, there's no more need to move them ever again. So you need to put little pieces of aluminum angle on each side. Just use a self-tapping screw, screw it right into the aluminum bar. So where they cross and where it holds that projector, it can't slide on that pole anymore. It's stabilized. The second thing you need to do is once you get the projectors spun in to where they're going to be presenting on the screen, you need to go back into that wooden projection box mount that they make, and you need to either clamp it or screw it together because they're made on a base that's able to turn, so you can turn that projector to get to the perfect location. And they have screws in there that gives it a little bit of attention, but the wood will expand and contract 1 millimeter and your picture is off. So either get yourself some small C clamps and clamp it on two sides so it can't ever move again, or do what I did, just put screws through it. Because once you mount the projectors and you get them in the perfect position, there's no reason to ever move them again. So I just pre-drilled some holes in it, used regular drywall screws, went right through the tops on each side, screwed them up nice and tight, and kept those from moving anymore. These problems and the diagnosis that I'm giving you, when you're trying to warp the image on the screen and you're wrestling with this thing, trying to get that perfect image, you're not realizing that one pole over here has dropped a little bit and you don't know about it, or these have moved and you don't know about it, or they've twisted and you don't know about it. It's just several things you need to do to lock this system down so it can't move. So now the only equation that you're worried about and that you're fighting is with the warping technology and on a combination of everything else that goes along with it. Now you probably saw the picture early on where I put the hood over top of the system. I just did it with these furring strips that I bought. They were 8 foot long and screwed them in around the rail and made, you know, kind of like a teepee effect with them going all the way over and screwing on both sides, and then bought some denim and just pulled it tight and stapled it on there. You notice I don't have any projectors there because I got rid of the short throw projectors and I went to long throw 4K projectors. Now, if you want to know how to do that, you have to contact me because it takes a lot. There's a lot of math involved in long throw projectors onto this screen so that you have all the full proper resolution, which brings me to another point that we need to cover right now. Even with the short throw projectors, when you put your short throw projectors on there, you're going to have an overlap in the middle of your screen. And the warping programs tell you that when you set up your projectors, you want your projectors to have a large enough picture that it goes over top of and outside of the presentation screen, which is true. But remember this. Don't get crazy with that because you have to, how can I explain this properly? When you put the projector onto the screen, you've got to make the image large enough that it goes outside of the screen to cover everything because your projector is pointing to the center of the right side and the center of the left side and overlapping in the middle. So when you put it up there and you're dealing with a curved screen and you're throwing a flat image out there, the corners of your image are going to be inside the screen while the middle of it is going to be right at the edges of the screen. So you have to back the camera off enough to make sure that your video presentation on the edges are outside of the screen. But just remember this, the more that you put it outside of the screen, the less resolution your final picture is going to have. Because when you go into your warping program to fix this, you're cropping this back onto the screen, but you're not, if your resolution, if your presentation is way out here, outside the screen, that resolution in that square right there is what you're going to lose when you map it on the screen to fix this. So make sure that the picture that you put on the screen before you start to warp it, you have it overlapped with your other projector, isn't oversized. Make sure that you're using the minimum amount possible to make sure that your projector is getting all of the picture on the screen. I hope that's clear. So if you bring it all the way out here and you bring it all the way out here and all the way down here because, oh, look how much I overlapped it. Oh, that works great. When you sit down to do that, all of that resolution that's out there, you're going to lose. You're not compressing the image back onto the screen. What you're doing is you're cropping the image off the screen when you go back to warp it. So whatever's on the outside is a resolution you're going to lose in the final presentation. When you're making a decision about what projector to use and you're going to mount the projectors on the SimPit technology sim, you want a projector that has the lowest input lag possible. Because believe me when I tell you, most projectors out there are not gaming projectors and they have lags of like 90 or 100. I use the BenQ TH671STs because they are gaming projectors and they had the lowest lag of any projector on a short throw projector that was out there. That was, I don't know, a year and a half ago. Maybe they make something different now. I'm sure they do. But just pay attention that they tell you in here when you're reading through it what its lag is because you don't want something, especially if you're playing PvP games. It really doesn't matter much in aviation games that you have a lag. I mean, that's not going to do anything. But PvP stuff is going to kill you. For the long throw 4K projectors, this is what I selected because at the time that I selected them, they were the lowest lag 4K long throw projectors that were out there that were in the market. Now, I know we discussed about using a laser level and wasting your time. What I meant by that, I don't mean you don't need one. You got to have a self-leveling laser. You just got to have one. There's just no other way to do it. This is the one that I found. They're not real cheap. They're over 200 bucks, but you can pick them up at Lowe's and Home Depot. You could probably get a cheaper one than that one. I might have gone just a little bit overboard, but you got to have a self-leveling laser, even using the camera system. You're going to want to set your screen level for whatever desk you're going to use. Now, I purchased the desk from SimPit Technologies. And I made a flat table to go on top of it for what I was going to do with it. Some people don't put tables on them, but I was doing everything. I was playing PvP and playing aircraft games, so I needed a table for keyboards and all my other stuff. But just make sure before you sink everything down that you have the right level for whatever desk you're going to put in there. Just to give you an idea of what I spent on everything that I did. That's the total that I spent when I built mine, but you don't have to spend anywhere near that much. That includes four projectors, by the way, and a seat from a tractor trailer that I used, the Bostrom seat, $1,300. It's a tractor trailer seat, and it needs a compressor to run it because I wanted to go up and down. I wanted something comfortable because I'm going to be sitting in it for a lot of hours. These are the prices of the projectors, so that price includes four projectors. And these prices have come down, by the way. I think that the 1080, the BenQ 1080 Pros are like six something now, and I think I saw these at around $899 for the 4K Pros. But anyway, this is what I paid for everything without shipping. So, well, yeah, they're shipping for everything. So that'll give you an idea of what I spent on the system that I built. But you can do it for a hell of a lot less money than that. So if you decide to buy the FlyElise Software Immersive Display Pro, you're going to need both programs. You're going to need Immersive Display Pro, and you're going to need Immersive Calibration Pro. All right, so here's the deal. A lot of people save some money and they buy the Advanced because it's 180 euros, 210 bucks, something like that, because it says it works for three projectors. And they overlook buying the Ultimate because it says it's for 16 projectors. But here lies the problem. The Advanced does not do auto alignments and they do not do camera-based alignments. So that means that you have to do everything manually. And believe me when I tell you, it's an impossible task. It is for me. Maybe somebody better than I can do it, but I could never do it manually and get it to work. If you buy the Ultimate, then the camera-based auto alignment and the auto alignment comes with that, which means it finds the individual pixels, it lines up the individual pixels, and you don't have to sit there and struggle for hours trying to line all this up. At 380 euros, it's about 450 bucks is about where it is, maybe 470. Let me check. $450 is what it cost. But this will save you hundreds and hundreds of hours. Believe me, you'll forget what you paid for this when you realize that it actually does auto align. All right, so as I broke away from the video to try and set up a system to show you guys step by step how to do this with a camera, I don't have the SimPit technology pit anymore. I sold it. Not because I don't like it, and not because it didn't do as advertised once I overcame all the problems, just because I prefer VR, and that's my VR setup. I've even got a 50-inch Samsung curved screen, but I prefer the immersion over the SimPit technology and over using my larger screen. So, because of that, I opened up the immersive display system and I thought it had a simulator in there to allow me to step through the process, but it does not. So, with that being said, what I'm going to do, I've got four guys right now that are trying to set up a new system. And if one of you guys want to contact me and you'll allow me to get on your system via TeamViewer, I will actually set up your system and I'll record the process and I'll come back with another video so you guys can see step by step exactly how to do this. But there's a caveat in this. You have to have the Ultimate Edition. Without that, camera doesn't work. I would never try and align this system with a non-camera FlyElise program. It's murder. I've tried it. It sucks. The camera I use is a Logitech Brio Ultra HD webcam. It's a little more expensive, but it's HD, and the better the camera, the better the result. But you can use any webcam that you might have to set this up. But that's the system that I use. So once you get to the point where you have your two projectors set up, with minimum amount of spillage over the screen, And you can see what I mean by this display here. If you look right here, you are going to have a gap there. There's nothing you can do about it. Don't take these and put them up here trying to fill that gap, because you're losing more in resolution than what that little piece is worth. And quite frankly, when you get your desk up to it, it's totally unnoticeable. So you want a minimum amount of spillage on your screen to get the best preview possible when you get your two projectors set up with this overlap. Once you get into the Flyly software, you're going to have to set up your screen with rows and columns. Now, this individual is using 4 rows and 10 columns. I use 10 columns and 1 row. It just makes it simpler, and I'll be able to show that to you once somebody calls me and I get a video of a screen and how it works out. You're going to go into the software and you're going to select the camera that you're going to use for your screen. Once you make that selection, it'll come up and the camera will come up and you'll be able to see the display area of what your camera is looking at. But what you're going to have to do is move your camera back till you get both screens inside the camera so that you can mask them and also set up your columns for the camera to calibrate everything for you. So once you click on in here where it says mask, it's going to set up these points around the screen for you. Normally it sets 3 across here and 3 down the bottom. This particular individual is going to use 2 points on the top and bottom. Let's see if I can move that up so you can see down here where he's selecting that. That's where you select the number of points for the mask. Once you select the number of points that you want, you drag them down to the edges of the screen. Now what this is doing is it's going to mask the screen for the camera, so it won't recognize anything outside the screen. Once you get this square made with these 4 points, you're going to come down here to the bottom. I'll try and move this and show it to you again while he's masking this. You're going to come down here to the bottom and you're going to put more points on there. I suggest 7 across the top and 7 across the bottom, but you can set those. I think he sets probably somewhere around 4 or 5, but you can see where it's at the edges of the screen for the 4 points that he set. So he's going to go down to the bottom, he's going to make more points for the mask, and then we're going to get a little closer to the actual screen size. Now you can see where he's made additional points here to bring the centers up to the screen to mask off the camera so it only sees the screen and the projection. He's going to make some more points now, bring those onto the screen, and then move those individually up to the edges. Now remember, once you do that, you have to place them by hitting, I believe it's Control and your mouse, that places them permanently on each point of the screen. Don't forget while you're doing that to continue to save your project, because one thing about Flyly is you get too many points out there and you don't save them, it'll crash and you got to start all over again. But once you get this screen masked properly where the camera only sees what the projectors are projecting, then you can start the calculation process without using a laser to go through all of the problems of all of the squares across the screen. Now, once you have the screen properly masked, where the camera is only looking at the projection on the screen, you can go up here to projector 1 and projector 2, and it's going to display circles on the screen so that the camera can detect them and see where each projector is looking. So when you click on projector 1, you'll see that it displays all the circles that are going to be on the screen only from projector 1. And then on projector 2, it'll do the same thing for the right side of the screen. Now you're ready to calculate, and the camera will be looking at the actual pixels on the screen, aligning all of these circles for you so you don't have to do any of this. Once you hit the calculation process, you'll see different colors of circles flashing on both sides of the screen, and it'll be aligning all of these pixels up for you so you don't have to do it. By the time you're done using the camera to auto-generate your picture and get your overlay done, this is what's going to come up after you calculate, and it's absolutely perfect every time. The problem with FlyElise and the rest of these things is most of the videos that are on YouTube are 4 years old or older, and there's been lots and lots of upgrades and updates to the software since then. I had to punch through this stuff to figure it out for myself, and I apologize. Today, I saw this thing on Facebook, and the guys wanted me to make a video, and I jumped off on the deep end before I realized that I couldn't actually do it and operate the program without projectors. But again, with that being said, as soon as one of these guys call me, which will probably be tomorrow, I will set up a screen. I will do it point by point and click by click so you can see everything and how it's done. It's a one-stop shop. It's very easy to do. And once you've done it this way, I just don't understand why everybody uses lasers with all the squares and all the stuff they do, unless you're just being cheap and don't want to buy the ultimate package. So guys, with that, I apologize for biting off a little more than I could chew today. I didn't know I couldn't get in the FlyElise software to show you everything step by step. But I'm sure one of the guys will contact me tomorrow and I'll go through everything. I'll get it all recorded and I'll put it up here for you. It's very easy to do with a camera. It's a very simple system and it'll give you the perfect blend on your overlap every single time. Until then, I'll see you in the skies in DCS, and I'll get this video up to you just as fast as I can. Thanks, fellas.